Good afternoon, Crossover. Make some noise for the Lord. It don't take a lot to praise the Lord. It don't take an army of folks. All it takes is two or three. They just want to get it in for them. Y'all ready?
Be lifted high. Be lifted high. Higher than anybody can lift the God. Everlasting Father, all consuming fire. I give you my praise.
Be lifted high.
Be lifted high. Higher than anybody can lift the God. Everlasting Father, all consuming fire. I give you my praise.
We can praise the rapper for his blueprints. Acting for his shipwrecks in the walk of fame, or an artist for his nudist. Sculpture of a dude, and I credit to who is do this. Me attitude, I'm better than you, got me tripping. Say I'm tripping, but not to be confused with this culture in his views. Entertain or interviews, but expose them unto the truth. Be living examples, proof of a God that's living worthy. Praise is just what we do, so get your lighters up. Cause the word is from fireman. Have you running, but not burning. Spreading the fireman. Call the fireman, Christ is the lighter man. So get your hands in the air. Get up out the chair, yeah.
Be lifted high. Higher than anybody can lift the God. Everlasting Father of consuming fire. I give you my praise.
Be lifted high.
Be lifted high. Higher than anybody can lift the God. Everlasting Father of consuming fire. I give you my praise.
To God be the glory for the things he has done. So loved the world that he gave his only son. Yep, died on the cross so the victory is won. That he got in my footsteps, now I got a new step. Some worship money and the luxury it brings. Others live for fame, I'm worshiping idle things. But this kingdom business, worshiping our king. Heaven and nature sings, sing praises into his name.
Be lifted high, hey. Be lifted high. Higher than anybody can lift the God. Everlasting Father, consuming fire. I give you my praise. Be lifted high, higher than anybody can lift a God. Everlasting power of consuming fire. I give you my praise.
Put your hands up high,
hands up high, hands up high.
Put your hands up high,
hands up high, hands up high, hands up high, hands up high, hands up high.
You know he's alive.
Hands up high.
Put your hands up high,
hands up high, hands up high, hands up high, hands up high, hands up high. Hands up high, hands up high,
he's worthy.
Be lifted high, be lifted high. Higher than anybody can lift the God. Everlasting Father of consuming fire. I give you my praise. Be lifted high, higher than anybody can lift the God. Everlasting Father of consuming fire. I give you my praise.
Make some noise for the Lord. Worship him in this place.
Two, three, four.
Loves and sends it.
crossover. How's everybody doing? How many of you guys know that no matter what you do in life, God will never give up on you? He will never run out on you. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love, your love, higher than the mountains that I face, stronger than the of the grave, a constant in the trials and the chains. That one thing remains, one thing remains.
Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love,
your love, your love. And on and on and on and on it goes. It overwhelms and satisfies my soul. Never ever have to be afraid. That one thing remains, one thing remains.
Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love,
your love,
your love.
In death, in life, I'm covered by the power of your.
I give myself away so you
sing it to him.
I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away.
One more time, one more time.
I give myself away, all my life, all my heart to you.
I give myself away, yeah. So you can use me.
Praise God, hallelujah. Praise God. Isn't it good to feel his presence? Isn't it good to feel his presence? How you doing, church? You doing all right? Good to see you all today. Look at the person to your right and to your left and say what's up to somebody. Welcome here to the house of God.
For 19 years, more than 5 million women have gathered at Women of Faith. This year, come with us on a journey that will take you from survival to revival. 20 cities, one tour. America's leading Christian event for women is sharing that God loves each one of us. Enjoy a day and a half of laughter. Encouragement.
We have to stop believing we don't have value and we don't have worth. In Christ, we have a whole new existence.
I want you to leave this place in just a little while completely encouraged that God has got your back. He is willing to work alongside of you as you and I grow and become the women that God has called us to be.
Heartfelt worship. And deeper Bible teaching.
Because of Jesus, we can boldly declare, I will rise.
This is a love story about this amazing God who is absolutely smitten with women who have mistake chapters in their stories.
You're still here, you're still alive, you're still fighting, there's still hope, there's still a future, there's still destiny. Do not give up.
Sunday Night Vibe, how y'all feeling tonight? Crossover was good. Where's all the ladies at in the house? Make some noise, ladies. So if you didn't connect it, that is a big women's event that's coming up in just a couple of weeks, and it's actually going to be going down right here at Crossover. So you definitely want to find out some information about it. It's in your program. You can sign up at the table out there, the chosen women's table in the lobby. And where's all the fellas at? Fellas, where you at? Give me some bass. Don't feel left out because we got some great stuff coming up in the men's ministry. We call it Fight Club, Fight for the Things That Matter. We're going to be doing a big game night. We're going to be having some fun together. That's coming up in a couple of weeks in November. Get some information at the table. There's going to be all kinds of games. I heard we're going to be playing laser tag and everything. It's going to be real crazy. So we're so glad you guys are here tonight. If you don't know me, I'm Tommy. I'm the lead pastor. We're glad you guys are here at Sunday Night Vibe. Somebody say, I was born for this. We're doing our series right now, continuing it tonight. When you guys walked in, you got a program. You could pull that out. Inside of there, we got the connection card. You guys could please fill that out. That's how we know you were here. We want to connect with you. We want to hear what's going on in your life, what we can pray for, what we can celebrate with you. T- tell us the good things that are happening as well. If you guys are watching online, everybody say what's up to the people online. Woo! People are watching from all over the place. We're glad y'all are with us tonight as well. You can fill out a connection card through the website so we can pray for you as well. We pray for those needs every single week on Wednesdays with our staff. Yeah, so y'all feeling good tonight? I just got a couple quick announcements to let y'all know before the big announcement, okay? So anybody know what next week is? Next week we are celebrating 4 years that we've been in this building. How many of y'all know this used to be a toy store? Yeah. And then we retrofitted it into a church, and next Sunday we'll be celebrating 4 years that we've been in here. We're going to be having a huge water baptism next week. My man 13th Disciple is going to be in the building as well. So you definitely want to invite some friends. We're going to give you some cards to invite some people. Next week we're going to celebrate all the amazing stuff that God has done over the last 4 years. It's going to be awesome. Next week we're also going to be starting our new membership class. So if you guys haven't officially gone through the membership class, we do have that here. That'll tell you everything about what the church believes, what our vision is, how you can plug in, how you can grow, how you can be a bigger part of things. It's at the 6 o'clock service or at the 10 a.m. service. It's during the service. It's in a classroom right in the back of the building. So if you're interested in checking that out, just check that off on your connection card, and we'll send you an email this week and remind you. We'll probably call you as well to remind you and let you know where it's at if you have any questions. And if you're here for the first time tonight, or the second time, or the third time, we'd like to call you our VIP guests. So give it up for the VIPs in the building tonight. Don't worry, I'm not going to come up and like give you the mic. You know, nothing crazy like that. Just simply come hang out with me after service in the center of the lobby. There's an area that says VIP area. I got a free gift I'd like to give you. Just like to give you a handshake, a pound, you know, high five. You know, if you got any questions about the church, come over and hang out with me. And my man Greg Harris, he was up here rapping just a little bit ago. Stand up real quick, Greg. Y'all give it up for my man Greg Harris. He is our college director. If you didn't know, Crossover has its own college, Crossover Urban Leadership College. So if you feel called to learn more about the Bible, or if you feel called to be in ministry, whether that's youth ministry, or if you feel like God's calling you to be a missionary someday, or even to be a pastor someday and start a church or plant a church, we have a college here. It's legit, meaning like it's accredited. It's not like just go to this class and then we'll give you a little piece of paper. Like, no, this is a fully accredited school, which means you can get financial aid, you can get grants. So if you have any questions or you have any desire to be plugged in with that, see my man Greg in the lobby afterwards. He'll give you the 411 on it. And now for the big announcement. Did y'all get my email or see on Facebook? Like, we had a big announcement. Okay, so we need everybody to like give a drum roll. All right. Well, here it is. Crossover has been praying for a while to find someone to come in to be on our team, our leadership team, to help organize things and really help take things to the next level. And so we've been looking for someone to take the position of being the executive pastor. I'm the lead pastor. We have Pastor Lands that does discipleship in small groups, and we have a few other people on the staff that do an amazing job. But as our church continues to grow, we've been like, man, God, send us the right person that can really come and help us structure things to really go to the next level. So as we've been praying for many months and been in conversation, we have found that special person. He's from very far away. Yeah. So Crossover family, if you would help make some crazy noise and welcome our new executive pastor. Y'all give it up for my man, Chris Brooks. Show him some love. Come on up, Chris. Yeah. Man, we got the strobe going for you. Woo! Yeah. I want to invite the Crossover staff and some of the leadership team, the elders. If you guys can come on out, we're going to go ahead and pray over Chris. And as they're coming out, let me just share a little bit about Chris. I've known this brother now for over 10 years, and I'm actually good friends with his pastor that he was part of this church that started in Minneapolis called Sanctuary. And out of any church in the world, that church is the closest to Crossover. They're multi-ethnic, multi-generational. They have a DJ on the platform. They use hip-hop and R&B and the arts, and they're around the same size. They do multiple services like us. They're crazy like us. They get it. And so this brother has been part of that church and part of the leadership team there over the years. He's also Worked for Willow Creek Association, which if you know anything about Willow Creek, it's one of the largest churches in the world. He's worked for World Vision as well. They're a big missions organization. He's worked in a church as a youth pastor before, and currently he's been a professor at a Christian university teaching urban studies and youth ministry, and he's also a corporate consultant and a consultant for large nonprofits and churches. So we are getting a consultant. Yeah. But I say, ooh, yeah. So really excited about him joining the team. We're just super amped about him and his family that's going to be here. So just want to give you the mic. Say what's up to everybody.
How you doing, Crossover Church? Yeah. So I'll keep it brief. My wife, Bobby, we have four kids. We're very excited to be coming here. We've been talking with Tommy and praying about this decision for about 6 months. It's been a long process, and we're very excited. My background, I'm a college professor, Tommy told you that, but my background really is I've done youth ministry for many, many years. I've been an executive, and my graduate studies were in business and global leadership. In my heart, y'all, I'm a pastor, right? So I'm like a business pastor. So coming to Crossover is exciting because Crossover's got a lot of really, really good things going on. So it's one thing when you have to go to some place where there's like all this broken stuff and stuff's all messed up and you got to go fix a bunch of stuff. That's not the case here. I get to come and just join the stream of what's going on, and it's amazing. So we're grateful that God chose us to come. We're grateful that the leadership team chose us to come, and we'll be moving down here at the end of December, starting on January 4th. So I look forward to meeting all y'all very, very soon.
So I want to ask you guys to stand up with us. We want to pray over Chris and pray that God's just going to continue to put the pieces together as they get ready to move down here. They're going to be moving over the Christmas holidays. They have four kids, and to get the kids plugged into schools and all that good stuff. So if you want to just reach your hand, I'm going to ask Pastor Lance if you want to go ahead and just lead us, bro.
Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that we can come before you tonight, Lord, and we lift Chris up before you. We thank you for his heart. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that he wants to be a part of what you're doing here at Crossover, Lord. And Lord, you brought him to us and his wonderful family, Heavenly Father. Help us to love them, Lord, in a real tangible way, Lord. They have given up so much and come from so far, Heavenly Father, to be a part of what you're doing. Father, we love Crossover Church, and we love the fact that Crossover Church loves you, and we love the fact that they're coming, Heavenly Father, to partner with us, to link up with us arm in arm, Heavenly Father, so we can be about the business of claiming Tampa Bay area, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, and by the power of your Spirit. So, Father, we love you, and we appreciate all the good things that you've done for us so far. And, Lord, we are excited about all the future things that you're going to do, all the good that's going to come as a result of this partnership and Chris and his family being here and all the learning that's going to be done and all the lives that are going to be impacted, Heavenly Father, and the souls in the name of Jesus we're claiming that will be saved, Heavenly Father, because of the change and the good things that he will bring. So, Lord, we love you and we thank you. And we pray all these things in your son's most precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, before you sit down, tell somebody you were born for this.
Mother's womb, I knew you, sanctified you from birth, Alpha and Omega. I knew your beginning and end before it began. I am the ghost of Christmas past, present, and to come, Ebenezer. I knew your past, present, and your future all at the same time. My thoughts are not your thoughts, but you were conceived in my thoughts before your mother conceived. Before I spoke the galaxy, stars, cosmos, and oceans into existence with one exhale of a breath, your purpose was already planned, predestined before the foundations of the earth. Fearfully and wonderfully, I made you in my image. From dust I breathe breath into your nostrils, and you became a living soul for such a time as this.
My friend, you were born for this.
Sunday Night Vibe, you were born for this. Yes. You guys excited to be here tonight? Yes. I'm excited to be with you guys as we wrap up our series that we're doing, Born for This. This is our third week, and I get to share with you today about a woman in the Bible. But before I do, I want to do a quick recap of the past 2 weeks. So the first week, if you remember, that was 2 weeks ago, we talked about Jeremiah. You guys remember that? And so Jeremiah, God called him to courageously lead the nation. God told him that I knew you before you were in your mother's womb. And he said, I'm going to give you the words to speak to the people. And so that's what Jeremiah was born to do. Last week, we talked about Jonathan. And we learned that Jonathan, he had every right to be the next king. It was, you know, part of it. He had every right. He was next in line to be the next king. But we learned that instead of him being the king, he was born to protect the king. That's what he was born to do. And we realized that not everyone in here knows exactly what they were born to do. Some people still are trying to figure that out. But there was something that stuck out to me last week. And that was that even just the pursuit of trying to find out is just as important as having the answer. See, because the answer is not just going to fall on your lap. You're not just going to wake up and, oh, I get it now. That's what I was, you know, born to do. It doesn't come that easy. You have to put some action into it. You have to pursue it. But I do know one thing, and that is that we're all called to serve God, all of us. We're called to serve God and to serve other people as well. And so even though you may not know exactly what you were born for, like you may not be able to say, I know what I was born to do. We all have a calling on our lives. Believers that are in here, we have a calling on our lives, and God has called us to serve him and to serve other people. And I'm sure that there's times where it might even be in front of your face. See, but you don't realize it because a lot of times we're thinking that it's supposed to be some great big title, like a doctor or a rapper or president of a company or you're supposed to be a leader. We kind of look towards those big titles, that big thing, and it's not always like that. It's not always like that, and we're going to see that with the story that I'm going to share. We also have to be careful. So let's say that you're doing something. You know that you are right now doing something and you're serving God, but we also have to be careful that we don't limit God and we don't limit ourselves. So for example, you might be a teacher in here and you might be a great teacher, but then don't just say, you know what, I'm a teacher and that's all I am, and you're going to put all your energy, your time, your resources into teaching and that's it. And that's all you focus on. And if you're a mom, maybe you're a full-time stay-at-home mom and you're raising your kids and you think, that's it, I'm just a mom and that's all I'm ever going to be. Unless you're Michelle Duggar from the Duggar family, the reality show 19 Kids and Counting, and you have a baby every year for the rest of your life, then that's completely different because you're going to spend the rest of your life trying to memorize your kids' names. That's different. But we have to be careful that we don't limit God and what he can do in our lives, or for us to think that's it. That's just the one thing that I'm going to do and that's it. Because we have to be careful with that God has so much more for each and every one of us. And when we look at the story of Jeremiah and Jonathan, we learn that they weren't born for themselves, were they? They weren't born to entertain themselves. No, they were born to impact the world. They were born to impact other people, to reach other people and point them in the right direction. And that was to their creator. That's what they were born to do. And so today I get to share a story with you about a woman who was born to do something that maybe is not that great or spectacular, yet she left a lasting legacy behind. And this is found in the book of Acts, chapter 9. And this is the story of Dorcas. Her name is Dorcas. Now, she may not be as popular or well known as maybe Deborah in the Bible. And if you read the story of Deborah, she was a female judge, and she was also a warrior. Like, she literally went out into the front lines. She may not be as popular or well known as Esther, who was born for this, for such a time as this. And she went and risked her life and went before the king, and she was able to save her family and her people as well. She may not be as popular as Mary. These ladies who were courageous, and we have great stories that we can look at. No, she was just an ordinary woman, just an ordinary person who did something spectacular, though. She didn't meet Jesus personally, but Jesus truly transformed her life. And so we read that her life deeply affected her community's life. What God had done in her life then went and it spread and it affected her community's life. Now, her name is Dorcas in Greek, and then in Aramaic, it's Tabitha. And so you might see in your Bible, you might see both names or just one, but they're the same person. And in, I know in my translation, NLT, it makes reference, they use both names in there. And so her name means gazelle. And a gazelle is an animal that can run really fast, up to 60 miles an hour. And gazelle means elegant and quick. Now, I don't know if anyone in here has taken Financial Peace University before, or you've heard, yes, you've heard of Dave Ramsey. And he talks about having gazelle intensity. He talks about when you're in debt, run like crazy to get out of debt with gazelle intensity. And so Luke is the author of the book of Acts. And what he does is he gives us this story of Dorcas and how elegantly and quickly she was able to impact the life of those that were around her. And so we pick up in verse 36 here. And it says, there was a believer in Joppa named Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was always doing kind things for others and helping the poor. And about this time, she became ill and died. Her body was washed for burial and laid in an upstairs room. But the believers had heard that Peter was nearby at Lydda, so they sent two men to beg him, please come as soon as possible. So Peter returned with them, and as soon as he arrived, they took him to the upstairs room. The room was filled with widows who were weeping and showing him the coats and other clothes that Dorcas had made for them. But Peter asked them all to leave the room. Then he knelt and he prayed. And turning to the body, he said, get up, Tabitha. And she opened her eyes. When she saw Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. And then he called in the widows and all the believers, and he presented her to them alive. The news spread through the whole town, and many believed in the Lord. So I'm going to share with you five different points, five things when it comes to the story of Dorcas. And the first thing is we want to look at a little bit of history. We want to know where is she from, what is this place. So the first thing is, where does she live? She lived in Joppa. And Joppa was 35 miles northwest of Jerusalem on the Mediterranean Sea. We learned that it was a seaport. So we had a lot of fishermen that were there. It was also a city, one of the earliest cities to have a Christian population. And so the evangelist Philip was one that he went through the whole Mediterranean Sea, all the cities along that border, and he evangelized there. He spread the good news about the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we know that where she lived, for the most part, was a Christian population there. And Joppa today is known as Jaffa, a suburb of Tel Aviv. The second thing that we're going to look at is her legacy. So we read the scriptures about Dorcas, and it really doesn't say a whole lot about her, but we do get a whole lot about her legacy and what she left behind. We know that her reputation was made from something as simple as sewing. That's what she did. She sewed clothes for the poor. Not that remarkable, is it? But yet, she surpasses the other woman in the Bible because she's the only woman in the Bible referred to as a disciple. She's the only one. So imagine that. She sews clothes for the poor, and she's referred to by Luke as a disciple. So this should teach us not to look down on practical serving. We shouldn't look down or undervalue practical serving. She was a disciple of the Lord, meaning that she was a follower. She wanted to imitate who her teacher was. And that's what she took her one gift, which was sewing, and she dedicated that to the Lord. It was out of gratitude for Jesus that she dedicated her one gift. Verse 36 says that she was always doing good and helping the poor. Always. Always doing good and helping the poor. Are you always good and helping the poor? I know I'm not. I'm not always good. Yet we read that Dorcas was always doing good and helping the poor. And I can guarantee you that you have a woman here that when we talk about her gratitude for Jesus and what Jesus did for her, that even though she didn't meet him personally, she didn't have the privilege of meeting him personally, but when she heard that he died on the cross for her, out of gratitude, she said, "This is the only thing that I can give you, and that's what I'm going to do, and I'm going to dedicate that to the Lord." And that's what we read here. She prompted on what Jesus had done for her. But I want to make a side note here that we talked about sewing and that she was sewing clothes. But did they have sewing machines back then? No. So she did this with her bare hands. Can you imagine how long that took? They didn't have the machines that we have now. They didn't have the robots like we have now. They don't have all the technology that we have now. So she did this with her bare hands. And we learn from scriptures that this wasn't an easy task to do. So she was doing two things. She was gathering the material together, gathering the items together, or she was purchasing her material, purchasing these items. The Bible isn't clear, but we know that she was doing either or. And then it says that making cloaks during that time was very difficult because it came from animal skins. They came from goat hair, camel hair, or wool. And so they had to take all this hair and have it woven together and then take the cloth and then sew that together as well. So imagine how laborious and tedious that job was. And that's what she did all the time. Always doing good and helping others. And because it took so long to make, they were considered to be valuable, and a gift, to get one of these gifts was an honor because they realized how much work it took for a person to make this. So her continual service to the needy not only speaks of a giving heart, but just of an opportunity to do something, her desire to help other people. And we can probably gather, too, that she was probably someone that had some kind of resources, some kind of means, because she spent her time and energy and focus on gathering these items, this material, sewing by hand, clothes and cloaks and so forth, instead of spending her time making a living. So we realize that she must have had some kind of means, some kind of income coming in order to do this. So she was not only giving of herself, but she was giving her resources, her finances as well. Now, I don't want you to dismiss this part and say, well, I don't have any resources, I don't have any means, or I don't have any time to dedicate like Dorcas has. Now, I know that we're good at that. We're good at making excuses. That's usually what we do. It's human nature to make excuses and exempt ourselves sometimes from doing something, whether it's for other people, for God's work, or giving towards God's work. And I also know that there's a lot of homeless people. We have poor people. We have people that don't have the resources that they need for them to get better with their health. I realize that there's people out in other countries living in horrid conditions. And I know that happens here, too, in America, that we're here and we have people in our own backyards. We have people in our communities that are just in the same boat as well. But I know one thing for sure is that I'm in America, and America is still considered one of the richest countries. And we still have one of the best resources here. We may not be perfect and have it all together, but compared to other countries, we're still a rich nation. And I don't know why God chose for me to be born here in America. I don't know why he chose for me to be here and not over there. I don't know why he chose for me to have all the options that I had here. Options of where to go to school. Options of where to work. Options of where to worship. Options, options, options. I don't know why he allowed me to be here and have all these options, and you have other people in other countries that barely have any options. That I can't answer. So we may not know why they have so little, but we do know why God has given us so much. See, because as his disciples, as his representatives, we have a responsibility to take care of others. We have a responsibility to take care of those that are in need. It's a privilege to be able to help others who are in need. And when you look at scripture, God has always set it up that way, where those that have resources and the ability to help others should do so. Just like we help try and feed the poor and we have outreaches, or maybe we'll do toys and backpacks for kids who may not be able to purchase it on their own. We have a juvenile detention center team, the crew, who goes out into JDC and they minister to our young and broken youth. We have a STEPS program here that helps families. And just like you saw that video from last week, the family that received the makeover, it was more than just a makeover, but we've partnered with local organizations and agencies here to help our community, because that's what we're about. Because we have a responsibility to help other people, and it's a privilege as well. See, God has always been mindful of widows, of those that are in need. God has always been mindful of that. And when you look at Joppa, we talked about it being a Christian population, but it was very heavily populated with widows as well. Orphans, because you had fishermen, you had merchants, you had naval seamen who were often shipwrecked and drowned, leaving behind widows, leaving behind wives and children, without a husband, without a father, and now without income as well. And so back then, the Lord had instructed his people that if a widow's husband had owned land, it went to the oldest son. And if the son didn't take care of his mother, which I think that's pretty messed up because you should, but if he didn't take care of his mother, then she had nowhere to turn for help. And if there was no son, she still lost her property and can only get it back if a relative of her husband's family would marry her. Just like in the story of Ruth and Boaz in the Old Testament. So one of the ways that we read that God instructed his people to take care of those that are in need, to take care of the poor, was by not harvesting the edges of their fields. So back then, they raised crops. And so he would tell them that you can go ahead and harvest, pick up your grains, pick anything up, but leave the edges, leave the perimeter for the poor. Let them pick that up. And then don't go back for a second time. You see, because a lot of times, whatever they were carrying, their bushel or their bucket, and as they were picking up the grains, you always had some that would fall. But God told them, you don't go back and pick that up. You leave that for the poor as well. Let them have that. And then check this out. It says that every third year, the owner of the land, the owner of the field, had to give up one-tenth, a tithe. He had to tithe one-tenth and give that to the poor. So whatever it was, he would pick up one-tenth of it and he would give it to the poor. Now, I'm sure all of us in here like some free stuff, right? Yeah. We would want that. And so, but check this part out too. Then every seventh year, every seventh year, whatever debt they had was completely canceled. So all the owners, if they had people that owed them money, on the seventh year, they had to cancel it to allow them an opportunity to start fresh and new. Now, if you have a mortgage payment right now, wouldn't that be nice? Car payment, credit card bills, knowing that in the seventh year, it's going to be completely canceled and you get to start fresh. You know, but so God always looked out for his people. And those that had resources, he instructed them to help others that were in need. Those who care for the poor receive God's approval, and those who do not are displeasing to him. But God approved of Dorcas so much that he allowed her to be raised from the dead. So the third thing that we're going to look at is her loss, her death here. And so losing her was a sudden blow to the community. As we read here, it was a sudden thing. They loved her. They cherished her. But I know one thing, that her influence didn't just happen. Them admiring her didn't just happen. Dorcas had to do life with them. She probably sat with them, talked with them, encouraged them, prayed for them. They did community together. They were in small groups together. They went to conferences together, like Joyce Meyer, Woman of Faith. They did Fight Club, not Dorcas, she encouraged the men to go, but they did Fight Club. They went to the women's ministry. They did life together. They went bowling together every Sunday night. Anybody in here went bowling last week?
Yeah.
So we had some people that went bowling. I kind of figured we'd have more people on the Sunday night because they have free bowling. I don't know if you guys know this, but there's free bowling at AMF on 56th Street. And last week, Monday, there was no school, and I got to go with my girl, so our whole family went. And so we're at the bowling alley, and we just had a blast. First of all, it's free. So, you know, I'll show up. I'll be there. But, you know, just to get together with everyone, especially after a long day at church, and just have a great time. Just, you know, make some jokes, laugh, and play games. We had a blast. But I need to talk to my Crossover family about that. This is a little teaching moment for all of us right now. Because I had a good time. I loved it, and I will probably go back again as long as it's free, right? I'm going to go back. But I was embarrassed last week. I'm going to be very real with you. I'm going to be honest because I love you. Because I love my church. But I was embarrassed. And this is why. As we were packing up and getting ready to leave, I think, after, you know, the games ended and it's time to go and putting on our shoes. We had taken over probably 7 or 8 lanes, maybe more of that. There was over 75 of us. Adults and children. So like this, we could have had our own church service there. There was a whole bunch of us. But as we were preparing to leave, I'm noticing that people are leaving and then there's trash all over the place. There was trash on top of the tables, under the tables. There was trash everywhere. And you see, this was free for us. So we shouldn't take advantage of the free part. I don't want them to look at Crossover and say, there goes that church again. That's that church that leaves this place looking like a dump. I don't care if you think that that's what they get paid to do. Shame on you if you think that. You see, we have a responsibility. This is part of doing good things, good acts here, acts of kindness. See, because I want to go back. I do, because it's free. I want to go back. But we shouldn't have this mentality of entitlement that it's free, I'm there, I'm going to bowl, and that's it. Because you're representing Crossover, you're representing Christ, even while you're out there. And so I went and I started cleaning up after you. And I know that whoever went in here, you didn't do it on purpose. But you see, I want to keep our reputation. I want them that when we walk in those doors and we walk out, they see Jesus. That's what I want. So whether it's bowling, or you're at the movie theaters, or you're at a different game, wherever you're at, clean up after yourself and leave a lasting legacy. Verse 37, it says, about this time she became ill and died. Her body was washed for burial and laid in an upstairs room. But the believers had heard that Peter was nearby at Lydda, so they sent two men to beg him, please come as soon as possible. But she's dead. What's Peter going to do? She's already dead. See, there's one ability that God desires among us. One ability. It's not accountability. It's not sociability. It's not reliability. It's not compatibility. It's availability. The greatest ability is availability. If we don't make ourselves available to God, no matter what kind of ability you have, it's of no use. It has no value. Ability without availability is a liability to God. And unfortunately, there are some of you in here that are a liability to God. You have to use what he's given you and make yourself available. But what is available? What exactly is availability? You see, availability is when you totally, absolutely, completely dispose yourself to God and say, God, here I am. When you give yourself to God completely for him to use you, through you, with you, for you, in you, when he chooses. That's availability. Giving yourself completely away to God to use you when he needs you. Peter was able and he was available. Dorcas was able and she was available, and God used both of them mightily. Verse 39, so Peter returned with them, and as soon as he arrived, they took him to the upstairs room. The room was filled with widows who were weeping and showing him the coats and other clothes that Dorcas had made for them. But Peter asked them to leave the room, and he knelt down and prayed, and turning to the body, he said, get up, Tabitha, and she opened her eyes. You see, Peter did what he learned through Jesus. He made himself available. He learned from his teacher, and he imitated his teacher. Peter simply copied what he had seen him do. In Mark chapter 5, Jesus raises a little girl back to life. So like Jesus, Peter therefore asked everyone to leave the room. And like Jesus, he took her by the hand and said, Tabitha, get up. And like Jesus, the Lord answered Peter's prayer and raised Tabitha from the dead. Now the Bible only mentions seven people who were raised from the dead. And Tabitha was the only adult woman that was raised from the dead. The fourth thing that I want to look at is that her life was the cause of an evangelistic explosion. In verse 42, it says that the news spread through the whole town and many believed in the Lord. We can read here that the life, death, and resurrection of Dorcas spread the good news about the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Now, she was irreplaceable. Dorcas was irreplaceable. She was cherished. She was loved. She was admired. They longed for her again. She was one of a kind, and they missed her deeply. But don't confuse being irreplaceable with being indispensable, because they're not the same thing. We're all dispensable. We know that tomorrow is not promised for any one of us. But indispensable is not the same thing. So we're each unique. Every single person in here is completely unique with the way that God has wired you and the way that he has shaped you. There's only one you. Thank God for that. And there's only one me. Thank God for that. Because we're all unique. God made us all differently. So when she died, the ministry did not cease, but it flourished and it expanded. That was the greatest legacy of Dorcas despite her loss. And the fifth thing talks about doing good and God's will for his people. God wants us to do good. I'm sure that he prefers if we were good all the time, always doing good and helping others. I'm going to go to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 through 10. And it says that it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. God has prepared some good works for us in advance for us to do. In these verses, Paul confirms that God in his grace did everything possible through the death of his son, Jesus, that we would have salvation. He made the way possible for us to have eternal life. And for us, it's by faith that we receive this free gift. And he also goes on to let us know that our purpose now is to do the good works that God has planned for them to do. You see, God knows what you've been born to do. Do you? Do you know what that is? What are the good works that he has planned for you? And maybe you aren't doing good works for you. Maybe he wants you to expand on that as well. If you're doing something right now, if you're serving, if you feel like, I know what I'm doing, I know what I'm supposed to do, maybe it's time to expand that as well. The Lord had asked Moses long ago, what is that in your hand? And Moses replied, it's a rod. Go and work with that rod, and you will be my servant, God said. Now, if God had asked Dorcas the same question, what is that that you have in your hand? She would have replied, needle and thread. And he would have said, exactly. That's what I want you to use to help my people. So what is it that you have in your hands tonight? What do you have? What is it that God can use? You see, if he can use a rod and he can use a needle and a thread, he can use anything. He can use anyone in here if we make ourselves available. It might be fixing cars. It might be baking. It might be cooking. Yeah, it might be sewing. You might like to sew. Whatever it is that you have, you can use that for God's glory. And if you're still trying to figure that out, what are you good at? What is it that you enjoy doing? What are you passionate about? What lights your fire? What energizes you? And if you're doing something, are you channeling that for Jesus? Are you doing whatever it is that you're doing? Are you doing it for the right reasons and not for yourself? Make sure that you're doing it to leave an impact and to help others. True faith expresses itself in deeds, not words. See, the highest calling in Christian ministry is to care in practical ways for the most vulnerable in society. That's our highest calling. We have an awesome responsibility and privilege to help others in need if we make ourselves available. Now, I know on Sundays, and you may have heard us talk about this before, but we have a Dorcas Society here. On Sundays, we have over 100 people that serve with us. Even throughout the week, we have volunteers that come and help us do everything that you see and everything that you don't see either. We have people that got here this morning and made sure that there was toilet paper in those bathrooms for you in the event that you needed to use it. There's people that walked through this building and made sure they picked up trash or they threw out the trash. They cleaned up the building for you. There are people that were here this morning, and they made sure that they were going to assist you when you were coming in through the driveway into our parking lot, because we want to have things in an orderly fashion and make sure that it's safe for you and for your family or your kids. We have people that got here this morning who turned on the lights in here, because it's not easy to turn on the lights in here. They turned on the lights, make sure the lights and the sound was working. We have people that during service, they're here and they're doing data entry for hours, because they take all these connection cards and they put it into our church database, and they literally type up every prayer request that you have, every praise report that you have, data entry for you. We have people here that serve with all their heart, with everything that they have to give, so that we can do good for others, for you, and for those out there in this community. But the sad thing is, that's only 10% of my church family that's part of the Dorcas Society. That's only 10%, because if we have three services on Sundays and we average close to 1,000 people here on a Sunday and we have 100 people serving, that means that's only 10% of my church family that's making themselves available for the work of God. It's a little sad, but we still love you. And that's why we're here, to give you an opportunity to know that God wants to use you, to give you an opportunity to remind you that each and every one of you have something special to give. But you have to make yourself available to do that. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. I thank you for my church family. I thank you, Father, for those who serve and serve with all their heart to make this possible, so that we can help others, not only in our church, but in the community and beyond. Father, I pray that you would light a fire in us. I pray, Father God, that we would be passionate and seek you with all our heart. God, I know that there's people sitting here and they still don't know what they're going to do. They have no idea what they were born for. But God, we know that we've all been called to do something, that you want to use us. God, may we have that passion and that desire to seek you, so that we could know how we can be an impact, that how we can know that we can reach other people. And I thank you, God, for those that are serving. I pray that they won't limit themselves either. God, that living for you is limitless. We can't put you in a box, because you have so much more in store for us. God, I thank you for my church family, because I know that you can cause an explosion to happen here at Crossover Church, an explosion that would impact Tampa Bay for you. God, I'm believing that for my church family. I'm believing that for those that are in here. God, remind us of how great you are, how mighty you are, and that you've chosen each and every one of us for such a time as this. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You guys have a great night. God bless you.
Good evening, Crossover. How everybody doing? Y'all good after hearing that awesome word from God?
Tough crowd right there.
Yeah, man. My name's Greg Harris. I serve here on the First Impressions. And like Pastor Tommy mentioned earlier, I'm the cohort director for the CULC College here. So if you're interested in that, come holler at me. Also, we're about to get ready to worship God through our giving. And giving is a big part of our DNA here at Crossover, because through giving, through our tithes and our offerings, you equipped Crossover to serve the people of this community and well beyond the boundaries of people, the people in this community. So we have multiple ways of giving. If you check out your programs, we have an envelope in your programs. If you on the web, you can go to our website and check out the website. And also we have an app called Secure Give. All you got to do is go to your app store, search Secure Give, download it, and boom, you're able to give to Crossover. We also have a kiosk out in the lobby. We call it our giving station. So you can go out in the lobby, you can use that, you can give with your debit cards. I don't know if you're like me, but I don't carry too much cash on me. So if you got that plastic, you can still give using that plastic outside. I'm going to ask everybody to remain seated as we enter into this part of worship. And also, if you filled out your connection cards, don't forget to put those in the basket as it's being passed out. You know, earlier I was earlier this week I was in a drive-thru at Burger King, and I seen this guy. He was going from car to car, and it dawned on me what he was doing, but as he approached the window, he kind of caught me off guard because he hit me with this story right off bat. He was like, "Hey man, my sister's been in an accident. She's pregnant. They rushed her to the ER in St. Pete, and me and my family, we're over here at the gas station. I'm just trying to get enough money so we can make it up there because she's not doing well." And like I said before, I don't keep cash on me, so I was like, "I'm sorry, brother, but I don't have any cash on me." And as he was walking, as he was leaving, you know, it dawned on me. I'm like, "Man, that's a terrible situation to be in." You know, and then it dawned on me. I'm like, "Man, earlier this week I got some cash." So I checked my wallet. Sure enough, it was a few dollars in there. And dude was clear across the parking lot, but I thought it was too late. Then I see him jogging through my right passenger window, and I let down the window. I'm like, yo, come here. So he comes back up. I give him a few dollars, and, you know, the drive-thru was moving extremely slow for some reason. So I look, and I see this brother bypass the gas station that he told me him and his family was at, and he kept clear across the street. I don't know about you, but I don't like being taken advantage of, you know, and that was one of those instances. And then a couple days later, I'm strolling through my Facebook on my phone, and lo and behold, it's a dude that he has a video up, and it's just like this lady that's panhandling. And, you know, he's hot with the lady because he's like, "Yo, I skipped my lunch a few days to give you extra money, and here it is, you getting in this BMW, you driving a better car than me," you know. And man, it's sad to say, but that's the society, that's the world that we live in. And you know, you can turn on the news, and when you turn on the news, you hear all the bad news about what's going on in the church. The pastor done did this, or somebody's taking from the church, and just abusing the funds and abusing the trust that people have placed, you know, in their leadership. But praise God, because that's not Crossover. You know, I don't know if this is your first time here at Crossover, but all you got to do is hang out for a little while and you will see the fruits of what your tithes and your offering help this ministry to do. So as we prepare our hearts to give to the Lord, would you please bow your heads with me? Most gracious God, Heavenly Father, we just come before you right now with thanksgiving in our hearts. We thank you for another day that you've blessed us to see, another opportunity to enter into this sanctuary, Lord God, and hear a powerful word from you, Lord. We thank you for the awesome example in which you've set before us in the example of giving, Lord. We thank you that you've given your best, and not only your best, Lord, but you've given of your only. You've given your only son to die in our place, and we thank you for that. We also thank you, Lord, that in spite of our giving, it does not change your position, who you are, what you're able to do, Heavenly Father, but it immediately affects, our giving immediately affects this church, and not only this church, but the people that are in this community in which this church works to serve, Heavenly Father. So just help us to be more like you. Soften our hearts that we don't bring our outside perceptions into your house, Lord God, and just give freely and give something that will be pleasing to your eyesight. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God said, amen, amen. Yo, check out this booth. It's round number 5. It's a hot little video.
Before my born day, yeah, way he had this plan. Knows the number of the hairs on my head like he knows the number of the grains on the sand. Hold up, seashore knows we're made to be more, to create, cultivate, and the whole tour of duty. We blind in our slumber, sleep with beauty. Wake up and bloom before the womb. Jeremiah, he knew me. And all the things I'm supposed to accomplish, and all these things I'm supposed to conquer, and all these things I always promised. The Jesu Cristo, I pay homage.
God blew that. She trained me, I'm a saxophone from the womb, I seen that lust bring. Now I try to be with that stacks of bones, every day on the ground, that just pour light. It's the best part of my wake up, it ain't enough to just talk it, gotta walk it, that's why my gate ain't shut. Uncover the muscle, uncover the truth, heal with the real, I'm airborne, and I'm a child of the Most High. Forbids life, yeah, get my air on, it's all bobbing out. Grace unfolding, victory abounds, I notice. I was given so much, so I fight for a lot, I was born for the journey, that coldness, that coldness.
Deep within my soul burns a passionate fire, filled with melodies and poems that I was born to write. So I sing to the heavens, yeah, and bring glory to the King of Kings, even if nobody's listening, 'cause I was born to this and I can go on forever, yeah.
Marry the groom and then worship the lamb. Born for this. Came out the womb with a mic in my hand. Writing, give it all I got. Grinding, just to get my spot. Climbing, just to reach the top. Crying, someone get the mop. It started at 15, just look at the split screen. Trying to spit clean while drawing my 16. But it wasn't a chapel. It was my rumble, my pen was a scaffold. 'Cause I was a surgeon. The very next year, I had my conversion. Then my faith and my rhymes began to start merging.
I'm an awkward Peter Parker with the heart of the carpenter. Walking on water, I'm not gonna stop talking about my God that pulled me out of the dark. I don't care if I'm harder, don't get me started. I'm a firebranded hand grenade that landed on this planet in 1981. My mama never planned it. I was supposed to be aborted in the belly of my mother and I should've died. I guess you know what it could've never really mean to think after considering the promise of the Most High. I was made for more than a microphone. At last the night is gone, the light is coming to sight. My eyes are open wide to behold Christ the Son. He's the reason that I was born.
Deep within my soul burns a passionate fire, filled with melodies and poems that I was born to write. So I sing to the heavens, yeah, and bring glory to the King of Kings, even if nobody's listening. 'Cause I was born with this and I can go on forever, yeah.
No. The saints of God and the angels clap when the sinner's home. Clap on. You can tell how we built and look how the bricks exposed. Yeah. We do it all for the glory, man. I'm just skin and bones. Looking over at the shine, but like, man, where the minutes go? Been at it since 95, long enough to fill sticks and stones. From G. Craig, I see the friction over what the scriptures show. I was in it by his grace and system before expensive homes, before expensive clothes, before tickets were sold. Part of the movement since the infinite, it is grown, it is on, it is gone to the mainstream where the sinners roam. Yeah, but is it helping? I said yes and no. Sometimes I used to love a kisser like mistletoe, but now my inner's grown. Yeah, now I just wanna protect and keep it from the vicious blows. The compromise and the written code, tap my eyes and it's a different goal. Copy God is bigger than pins and flows. The pinnacle's gotta be greater if you still on mission. Go!
Deep within my soul burns a passionate fire, filled with melodies and poems that I was born to write. So I sing to the heavens, yeah, and bring glory to the King of Kings, even if nobody's listening. 'Cause I was born for this and I can go on forever, yeah. I was born.
Yeah. What Were You Born For? That song is actually going to be coming out on a project that we're going to be releasing in January for free. So stay tuned, and you'll be able to get a copy of that for free, along with a bunch of other music as well that's going to be coming out for free. So What Were You Born For? Speaking of born for and born for this, today was our last day of the series. This morning we got to celebrate some babies that were born for a purpose and born for a reason, and we dedicated and prayed over them. And so tonight I heard there's a couple of families as well and a couple of babies that we're going to dedicate as well. So as we close service tonight, we're going to be able to do something special. And so I want to invite those families and the babies to come on up, come on down, and Crossover family, give it up for them. Make some noise for them. You guys can all come up on the stage. We got plenty of room up here, so come on up. And as they're coming up to the stage, this is something that we love to do here at Crossover. We get the opportunity to do quite often because y'all keep having so many babies. This morning, we actually dedicated 10 babies and young children in the 11:45 service. So there was like a whole choir up here of people. It was awesome. And the reason that we do this is because when we look at Scripture, we see that in the Old Testament and the New Testament, we see that when parents had a new child, they would bring them to the temple or the church, and they would have the spiritual leaders, the pastors, pray over them and dedicate them to God. And it's basically, in essence, how many of y'all have kids here? How many of y'all have dreams for your kids, right? Sometimes you like to live out your dreams that you weren't able to accomplish in your kids. It's good to dream for your kids. It's good to have vision for them. It's good to inspire them and push them. But ultimately, what it all boils down to is, what is God's plan? What was your child really born for? We've been studying that these last couple of weeks in this series, Born For This. And I had off the last 2 weeks. It was kind of nice. My wife, get up for my wife. She killed it tonight. Did a great job. Last week, Pastor Lance brought it. The first week, actually, I'm the one who kicked the series off, and we talked about Jeremiah. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 4, God said to Jeremiah, I knew you. I knew you even before you were in your mother's womb. But you know what? That translates to all of us here. That translates to these little ones that are right up here today. God knew them and had a plan for them even before they were in their mother's womb, even before they were thought of. And so tonight we're going to go ahead and we're going to pray over them and we're going to bless them tonight. And I'm excited. I'm all fired up. I had a break, so I'll be back next week for the big four-year celebration. We're going to get it in. But I want to invite you guys to stand with us as we get ready to close, and we have this closing prayer. If you want to lift a hand in just a moment. But let me say this before you put your hands up. I want to charge y'all as the congregation, the church family, the faith community. It's up to all of us to be a role model, an example to the young children of this church. I was just peeking my head in the gym a few minutes ago, and there's over 50 teenagers in the gym right now. Peeked my head in the kids' wing. There's over 50 children in the kids' wing. In the morning services, there's even a lot more people here in both of the services. And in the morning, we have over 100 kids in the services, in each service. So there's hundreds of children and teenagers that we minister to here each and every week. And we have to be an example and a role model, because how many of y'all know kids watch? They observe. They see what we're doing. So that's my charge to y'all, and my charge to you guys as the parents, as the family. It has to all start in the home. It can't just be, well, I'll just bring my kid to church. They'll teach him about Jesus, and it'll be good. It has to start in the home. You guys have to be the primary place where they're nurtured, and they're taught about God, and they're taught to pray, and you pray over them and teach them God's word. And we then come alongside of you and partner with you and supplement what you guys are already putting in place. And together as a team, it takes a village to raise the kids, and that's what we're here to do. So we're going to go ahead and pray for them now. So if you want to reach out a hand towards these babies. All right, put your hands out. Let's pray. God, we just come before you. We pray for Jocelyn right now, and we just lift her up to you, Father, and we just thank you for her precious little life. I remember when she was just first being born, and I remember her mom not being able to be around for a little while, and we miss them, and we're so happy that they're back around now, and she's healthy, and she's growing, and she's talking, even during the prayer. It's all good. And Father, we just pray for a special blessing upon her. And as she grows up, that she'll truly fall in love with you and she'll know you, as she's going to just have that environment at home that's loving and nurturing and you're in the center of it. And as she comes here to Kids Church, where even her parents serve many times and they love kids as well, God, that she'll continue to just fall in love with you and know you and follow you all the days of her life. You knew what she was born for. So we pray a blessing upon her in Jesus' name. And God, we pray for Amira. We pray for Amira right now. And we just lift her up to you right now. Just a little baby hanging out in the nursery every week in the crib. And God, as she's over there and getting nurtured and as she's going to continue to grow up and be in the other classrooms here as she becomes 2 and 3 and 4, and God, she'll learn the Bible stories and learn more about you. And she'll be learning about that at home as well. And as she feels that love and that environment at our house as well, I pray for her parents and her family and those that are around her, God, that you'll give them wisdom beyond their years, beyond their experience, God, just to pour into this young life. And God, we just pray that as she grows, God, that you're going to reveal to her what you have for her, God, and she's going to go hard after you. She's going to fall in love with you, God, and accomplish everything that you have her to be born for. So we pray for a blessing upon her tonight as well and her family. We pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Everybody said, amen. 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 Well, say what's up to these guys when they're out in the lobby. Congratulate them. Give somebody a high five. We love you guys. We'll see you next week at the 4-year celebration. There's some awesome snacks and some, the kids' ministry is having a bake sale out there. Go check them out. Get your sweet tooth on. Peace. God bless.